Hi guys, this is Elizabeth Cermak, Master Life Coach and Spiritual Coach, here every Tuesday at 3:33 to talk to you about my favorite topic and yours, creating and attracting your most beautiful life. And I'm on Instagram and Facebook Live. I'm going to give you guys a chance to hop on here. And this video is also going to be on YouTube later on my YouTube channel, Elizabeth Cermak, Your Highest Delights. And if you're watching this on YouTube or on Instagram or on Facebook, go ahead and like it. Drop me an emoji. Tell me where you're watching from. If you're watching on YouTube, go ahead and subscribe to my channel. And then you'll get notified when I put up a new video. So hi, Gary, good to see you. So today we're talking about how to heal our relationship with food. So recently I've had a lot of friends, I've had a lot of clients, I've had a lot of people approach me about this issue. So I figured it's time to do a video on it when I know that there's a lot of people out there struggling with this issue. And the issue is feeling out of control around food, feeling like we eat too much, feeling like we go on eating binges. And I'm going to talk today about some tips on how to heal that relationship with food so that you can be calm and peaceful and you can go into any situation where there's going to be a lot of delicious food and you don't feel like the food's controlling you. I tend to struggle a little bit with that word control because I don't believe that we don't want to control everything, but we want to feel more in control around food. So that's what we're going to talk about today. So like I said, I've had a lot of people approach me about this recently, so I've decided to go ahead and do a video on it. And in my time, I worked for over a decade as a psychotherapist, and when I was working as a psychotherapist, I actually specialized in eating disorders. So this is a topic that is near and dear to my heart. The eating disorders is the most deadly of all mental illnesses. So this was a very, very serious topic that I worked with. And it has overflown into my life coaching business, because with life coaching, you know, I'm working with clients who are higher functioning, but I still tend to get people who need to heal their relationship with food, especially women. You know, I don't know if I know anybody who has the perfect relationship with food. So if you're looking to heal that relationship and feel more peace when you're around food, this video is going to be for you. So like I said, this is a topic that's near and dear to my heart, and it's not just because I've worked with a lot of people with this very serious issue, but also because it's something that I have struggled with. So I struggled with binge eating from the time that I was in high school to the time that I was in my 30s. So really, and I talked about this on social media yesterday, I said that I was talking to my mom, I was probably about 30, and I was talking to my mom and I was telling her that I have to put the brown sugar Pop-Tarts. I don't know if anybody remembers those brown sugar cinnamon Pop-Tarts, that I would buy them and I would put them in the trunk of my car, because otherwise I would get up at night and eat them. So I had this like out of control thing going on around food from the time I was in high school to the time I was in college. And really, it all started with a diet. So you're gonna guess what my first tip is to avoid the binge, and it's not to diet. Because the first diet my first binge followed my first diet. Okay, so, and like I said, I'll tell you guys a little bit about my story. I used to really struggle with binge eating, with feeling out of control, restricting myself, and then just like, at a holiday or whatever, just totally letting it go to the point of me feeling sick and feeling completely out of control. So I'm going to tell you guys a little bit about, first of all, let's define binge eating. So if anybody's wondering, those who have struggled with binge eating probably don't need the definition, but if anybody's wondering, like, I don't know if I've been on an eating binge or not, this is the definition from a mental health perspective. So it tends to be that you're eating a lot of food in a short period of time, so usually like an hour, could be a little bit more, could be a little bit less. So you're eating a lot of food in a short amount of time and you're feeling out of control. So it accompanies this out of control feeling. I just realized I didn't finish my Pop-Tart story. So let's go back to the Pop-Tart story. So I remember telling my mom about those brown sugar cinnamon Pop-Tarts that were in the trunk of my car. I said, I have to leave them in the trunk of my car or I will get up at night and eat them. And my niece at the time, she was 10 years old, she overheard me. I was laughing about it. And she said, I don't think that's healthy. And it just totally woke me up when my 10-year-old niece said this, when she overheard me talking, because I decided I am not setting an example. This is not healthy. I am not setting a good example for her. From then on out, I just really decided to do the work and heal this relationship, heal my relationship with food. So like I said, you know, it takes time. And so before we even get into it, I want to tell you guys that it does take time. It takes spiritual, emotional, physical healing. There's a lot of things going on when we start binging. There's a lot of things going on with us chemically. So go ahead and make sure that you are talking to a doctor, that you're talking to a life coach, somebody who specializes in this area, or a therapist, because if this is something that you're really struggling with, it definitely takes a team of people to really figure out what's going on with you. And so that being said, I do have some tips today. So I got started talking about what a binge is. So to define a binge, it's eating a lot of food in a short period of time, and it's accompanied by a feeling of being out of control. And afterwards, usually you're experiencing a lot of guilt. So it's like this, I posted yesterday about that guilt that hurts our soul. You know, anybody who has been on a binge, an eating binge, knows that guilt afterwards, you know. So it's the most important things to remember is, it's a feeling of out of control while you're doing it, and then it's followed by a lot of guilt. And usually when you're on an eating binge, you eat even when you're full, you keep eating. So it's usually, not only do you have guilt afterwards, but you feel awful afterwards. Okay, hi Craig, good to see you. To my husband, hi Sergio, hi me and you in recovery. Good to see you guys, MSF, good to see all of you guys. So common binge foods, things that people tend to binge on are foods that are easy, processed, sugary, so cereal, chips, cookies, cakes, those things are all common binge foods, okay? So, you know, whether or not you experience binge eating regularly or you're just like feeling out of control around food and you feel like you don't want the food to be in control of you, this is gonna be for you. So I got my notes here because this is really important and I don't wanna forget anything. So my first advice I had already said, it's to stop dieting. So we know that restricting our food intake, like I said, my first binge followed my first diet. So we know that when we restrict our food intake, that triggers a binge. So you need to, I used to tell my clients who struggled with eating disorders is that like, we need to decipher, we're getting so much information and it's so tempting to go on all these diets that are out there because everybody thinks that they have the answer, right? And a lot of people do have really good advice. And you know, when it comes to health and when it comes to dieting and what to eat. But the thing is, nobody knows what is the best thing for you. So I used to tell this to my clients when they were struggling with an eating disorder. Like when you're in health class and that health teacher is talking about eating healthy, the health teacher's not talking to you. So I'm talking to like my eating disorder client. Because what happened was they would take it to the extreme. They would take this advice to the extreme. So obsessing, dieting triggers obsessing. And obsessing is no way to live. It's not a fun way to be. I don't care if whatever your goal weight is, say your goal weight is 125 pounds, the day you get to that goal weight, that is not going to bring you happiness. And I know we all know this, but we need to hear it. That goal weight, that is not where your happiness lies. Your happiness lies with you right now. And so treat yourself kind, you know, don't go on those diets. Know that maybe treat yourself a little bit differently than somebody who doesn't struggle with this stuff. Treat yourself a little bit differently and a little bit kinder. Okay, so that's the first thing, is just to stop dieting. Stop that now. Okay, so my second piece of advice is to eat high nutrient foods. So now that you are not restricting, we're not dieting, it's just important for you to feed yourself well. And I don't tell people what to eat, but we know what these foods are. They're whole foods, they have less ingredients. You know, I think when Whole Foods, the grocery store Whole Foods first opened, I think its goal was to have 5 or less ingredients in all of their products. So we want to have less processed foods, more whole, more natural foods that have high nutrients in them. Because if we're eating all processed foods, sugary foods that don't have a lot of nutrition in them, then our body wants more, more, more. Our body, our brain is not satisfied because we're not getting the right nutrients. So our body wants more, 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 and then that could trigger a binge. So say like you're only eating like, you know, say you feel proud of yourself because you didn't eat all day and then you had like chocolate cake for dinner and you felt full. Okay, that might happen once in a while, but if you're struggling with binge eating, that's probably not a good idea. And after a while, just eating things that don't have a lot of nutrition in them is gonna trigger a binge. Okay, so the next step is to think about what you can eat and not what you can't eat, okay? So now that we're not restricting, you know, you're probably making, at this point, you're making better decisions about what you put in your body. So you might decide to eat, and I'm not about restricting anything, unless of course you have like an allergy or something where you can't have food, but I'm not about restricting any. I'm not about ever saying, oh, I can never have that food again. Don't ever say I cannot have chocolate cake again. It doesn't work for me. As soon as I am told I can't have it, I want it. So think about what you can eat and what you can't eat. So now that you're not restricting, you might be deciding to eat less processed and less sugary foods because you know that this triggers a binge for you. And that's good. So that's not restricting. That's just deciding to eat something better than what you have been eating. So you might go through a phase where you start thinking about all the foods you can't eat. My husband does this. He's on here too. He does this. So we all do it. I've done it too. So instead of thinking about, I just recommend you move through that phase quickly. That's a kind of a normal phase. Like when we're trying to make a change in our life or get rid of something that's not helping us in our life, we kind of go through this phase where it feels a little depressing. But I recommend you get through that phase quickly by focusing on what you can eat. Remember, when we're a sacrifice is giving up something of a lower vibe in order to receive something of a higher vibe. So you're giving up these low vibe foods, these low vibe processed sugary whatever foods in order to get higher vibe foods. So you're making room for higher vibes in your life. Whenever you're saying no to something, you're saying yes to something else. So when you're saying no to those sugary processed foods, you're saying yes to some other delicious fruits and vegetables. So go grocery shopping. Focus on the foods that you can. Make it delicious. Don't eat anything that's not delicious. Don't eat it because it's just supposed to be healthy. That's no way to live. Living is about pleasure too. Like, we're supposed to be happy here in this world. So it's okay. Eat things that are good and healthy and delicious. Okay? So think about what you can eat and not what you can't eat. So say, for instance, you are trying to get rid of coffee. I've talked about this a lot because I've gone through phases where I won't drink coffee for a while. And what I notice is all of a sudden I focus on all the other things that I can have when I get rid of something. Okay? So focus on what you can eat, not what you can't. Also, eat mindfully. The next thing is eat mindfully. So everybody says that practice mindfulness. Well, what the hell does this mean? Eat mindfully. What do you mean, Elizabeth? I'm going to tell you what I mean because I feel like people don't actually tell you what this means a lot. Okay, mindfully, and this is something I used to work on with my clients. Mindfulness basically means using all of your senses. So when you're eating mindfully, you are only eating. And this is about you taking control over your eating environment. If we are texting, looking at our phone, answering messages, answering emails, thinking about what we have to do next while we're eating, we eat mindlessly. We're not thinking about what we're doing. Okay? And so like a lot of people will use this as an excuse and say, oh, I can't because I'm so busy. No, that's actually a choice that you're making. And this is hard to hear. This has been hard for me to hear, but I realize it's the beautiful thing about knowing that you have a choice is that you have control over it. So put the phones away. You know, when people used to eat dinner at 6 o'clock and not take phone calls, make sure when you're eating, you're just eating. Look at your food. You know, look at how beautiful it is. Really taste your food. Chew it. This is all eating mindfully. Okay, so, and like I said, it's up to you to take control of your eating environment. Make it a precedent in your home. You know, in this house, we eat mindfully and undisturbed. We respect this time to nourish our bodies. In this house, we eat mindfully and undisturbed. We take this time to nourish our bodies. We cherish this time to nourish our bodies. Say thank you. Say thank you before you eat. That's practicing gratitude. Okay, so those are the ones I just gave you, the ideas that I just gave you. I think there were four. Stop dieting, eat high nutrient foods, think about what you can eat instead of what you can't eat, and eat mindfully. So those four things are kind of holistic, right? They're holistic. They're ways to avoid the binge. They're ways to, but in the middle of a binge, it's not going to help so much, right? Or like right before a binge. So these next things that I'm going to offer you are actually things that you can do. They're good things to do holistically as well. Just like by holistically, I mean just like every day you do them and it helps prevent the binge. But you can also do these things that I'm going to tell you in the midst of it, or like right before. You want to catch it right before it starts. So, okay, so my advice, overall advice, is create some space between you and the food. And so this could be be before, like, if you feel like you're going to go on a binge, or if you just feel like you're going to eat something that you're going to regret later. It could be either way. Create some space between you and the food and get back in your body. So my theory is that I've always been very spiritual, even if I didn't know it. So my energy has always been a little bit, it could look kind of fly away. It's always been a little bit up here, right? So I really believe that when it was there was a lot of chemical things going on with me and everything too, but I believe that when I was binging, when I couldn't stop eating, it was because I was trying to ground myself back in my body. And it served a purpose. So it's good to notice that, to observe it, not to judge it, to observe it and to notice. It was serving a purpose. I wasn't crazy. I wasn't doing it for no reason at all. But the purpose was not healthy. It was not helping my life. It was actually making my life worse. So there's other ways to ground yourself and to get into your body and to create space between you and the food without doing the binge, okay? So the first thing I'm going to suggest, and so do all these things, these are three things that you can do before the binge or before you eat something that you're questioning if you should eat. So don't tell yourself, I can't have that cake. Just say, okay, before I do, I'm gonna do these three things first and I'm gonna see if I feel differently. Okay, deal? Okay, so the first thing I'm gonna suggest is a yoga pose. And before you shut me off, don't shut me off yet. Okay, I'm not talking about a yoga pose that you hate. This is all about comforting yourself, nourishing yourself. If somebody said to me, you could have that chocolate cake or you can go do the splits, because I hate doing the splits, I can't do them. If somebody said to me, you could have this chocolate cake or you could go do the splits, I'm gonna pick the chocolate cake. So I'm not talking about doing a miserable yoga pose that you hate. I'm talking about your favorite yoga pose, something that's restorative, something that helps you to feel good, something that makes you feel nourished and comforted, because we need to start soothing ourselves, comforting ourselves. So you could do like a child's pose, right? An embryo pose. I like legs up the wall where you sit. I won't do it right now because I got a dress on, but where you sit with your butt against the wall and you put your legs up in the air, because that helps with the fluids in your feet. That helps get your fluids running a different way. A forward fold. I like headstands. You know, you could do it against the wall or a handstand. Any of your, something that you really like. So try a yoga pose. And this is going to comfort you. You can imagine and visualize all the good things the pose is doing for your body, and it's going to create some space between you and the food. Okay, check. You got that yoga pose down. Second one, drink a glass of water. I know we all know this, but we have to hear it again. Water is so important. One of the things recently that I have found with myself is that I read this article about how when we're dehydrated, we can't sleep as well. So if you can't sleep at night, make sure that you're drinking enough water. That's a whole nother issue. But drink a glass of water. There's so many things that this will do for you. It will fill you up. It creates space between you and the food. When you hydrate yourself, you can think more clearly. You can make that a better decision for yourself. And maybe later you'll say, yes, I've thought about it and I'm going to eat this cake, but it's not a binge. I'm going to have one piece and no guilt. Okay? So that's fine. So try drinking a glass of water. Try a yoga pose and a glass of water. And now, if you really want to get crazy, add essential oil to the water. So according to Dr. Axe, and I'm going to put this in the blog, his website, grapefruit essential oil helps curb sugar cravings. And it also helps with depression. So think about it. This essential oil is helping you. Depression and anxiety go along with binging or feeling out of control around food. So this essential oil is not only going to help curb your cravings, but it's also going to help you to feel more upbeat and less depressed. What else could you ask for? So just, you know, full disclosure, I am a representative for doTERRA essential oils. And the reason why, I haven't talked much about this, but the reason why I decided to become a representative for them is that, I call it a wellness advocate for them. That's what the name is. But the reason why I decided to do this is because I had such a hard time finding quality essential oils. And when I was working, my work as a therapist, I wanted a natural way to help my clients that did not involve medication. Because everybody, when you in the field of therapy, you're really made to feel like you're doing a disservice if you're not recommending people to go to a psychiatrist. And the problem was, I knew how beneficial essential oils were, but the essential oils on the market, you can't necessarily trust. That's why essential oils have gotten kind of a bad name, because the ones on the market, aren't, they're synthetic, the ones out in the store, so they're not effective. So the problem, there was a problem finding high quality essential oils, which is why I fell in love once I found doTERRA. I just know that I can trust these oils. They are harvested all over the world. It's an amazing company that does just amazing things. So that's the only reason why I decided to be a wellness advocate for them, is because to help, it's just another level of helping my clients, right? And you don't have to try essential oils, but if you want to, this is a great company. Okay, so grapefruit essential oil helps with depression, helps with sugar cravings. And then the other thing I was going to say is, doTERRA has a metabolic blend, which is called Slim and Sassy. It's got peppermint in here. It's got grapefruit oil. It's got lemon oil, peppermint, ginger, and cinnamon. It smells cinnamony. And I've had clients who've had a lot of good results with this as well. You just put a drop in your water, drink it before the binge, either that or the peppermint grapefruit and you're going to feel more in control. Okay, so the last thing is, so we talked about yoga, drinking a glass of water, adding an essential oil if you want to do that. The last thing is to sit and breathe and get balanced, okay? So practicing mindfulness, we talk about mindfulness meditation, but just sit for 5 minutes and breathe. I used to tell my clients when I worked as a school counselor, when I worked as a psychotherapist, I used to say, smell smelly lotion, anything that smells good, that is comforting. But again, we're gonna run into a problem here, because what I realized is that all these products on the market, when you're smelling them, they've got a lot of chemicals in them, and they're not, so they might help you temporarily, but in the long run, they're not helping you be healthier. So again, I'm going to recommend essential oils. doTERRA has an awesome brand called Balance. So when we talk about balancing our emotions, this is like the best. Sit and smell something like this. So if you don't have essential oils, for instance, then smell flowers, smell herbs from your garden. Smell something delicious that's natural and that's good for you as well, though. Because I had to kind of get away from recommending those smelly lotions that were not healthy for my clients, okay? So go ahead and the sense of smell is the only sense that goes directly to our brain. So it really affects us when we can smell something delicious. It really affects our mood. And so if we do these three things, like if we do yoga, if we drink our glass of water, and if we sit and breathe and smell something delicious, that is going to change our frame of mind. We're going to have cellular changes in our body, and we are going to be less likely to be controlled by that food. Okay? And then you can make a decision. You can make a clear decision after that, because you're balanced, you're hydrated, you're calm, you've did your yoga pose, and you can go and you can eat mindfully. You know, no matter what, if you are struggling with eating either too little food or too much food, it's the same problem where you're not enjoying your food. There's this like myth in this society that in order to be healthy, in order to be, to look good and have the body you want, that you have to be miserable. And you know, you can be miserable and have the body you want, or you don't have to be though. So if you're miserable and have the body you want, you're more likely that body is not gonna stay, that you're gonna get a different body later, because you can't sustain that. Right? So it's better. You want to be happy. And it is possible, you know, it's been shown that people who are overweight are actually less happy. So it is possible to think about it that way. When you're trying to eat healthy and maybe not trying to eat so much processed foods, it doesn't mean, like, when you think about what you can eat, you know, think about what you're gaining, not what you're losing. They say that you have to be more, and I know this from personal experience, you have to be more emotionally attached to the outcome than to the temptations. So everything that I'm telling you about today is helping you to become emotionally detached from the temptations and become more attached to what you want from your life. So more attached to the outcome, whether that's like some beautiful wedding dress that you want to wear, or just feeling good in your body, like be more attached to that, to what you want, and to enjoying your food. This means you are dedicating your life, you're dedicating yourself to a life of enjoying your food. Why would we pick anything else, right? Okay, hi Juan. So it was so good to see you guys. Prudence, I put her to sleep as always. She's sitting here sleeping next to me. So if you guys have any questions, if you want to know any more information about anything that I shared, please contact me. If you're looking for a coach, somebody to work directly with and to help you heal your relationship around food, my email is elizabeth@yourhighestlight.com, and I will be seeing you guys there, and I will be seeing you guys here next week at Tuesday at 3:33. Peace and love. I'll see you guys later, and let me know if you have any questions. I don't think I see any here right now, but let me know if you have any questions, okay? Food peace. Bye.